Good morning, Bay Church. If you are willing and able, please stand and join us as we worship this morning.
What a joy I found in Jesus. What a gift it is to know the one who holds the heavens, the Savior of my soul. What a miracle it is to hear you speak to me. What a treasure to behold you, simply to believe. I'm so glad I met Jesus. Didn't know what I needed. Oh, but now that I've seen him, I have nothing left to hide. I'm so
I'm so glad I met Jesus. Can we celebrate him this morning? Thank you, Jesus.
Angels fall.
my life may be, I will give you every piece. I hear you call, I am available. I say yes, counting on your grace again. Less of me and more of you, we praise you, Jesus. I just wanna see you move. I say yes, oh. died for us. Lord, you long for us. We do the same. Jesus. Lord, your presence is all that we need. Jesus. We trust in your plan. Lord Jesus, we think about that one thing that we're holding on to. Lord Jesus, in this time, in this moment, we surrender it all to you. Lord, your way is perfect. We put it in your hands. Lord, your will, let your will be done. I surrender all. I surrender.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We come to you right now, God. And Lord, we admit we don't have what it takes to make ourselves right with you. We can work all we want. We can try all we want. But the reality is, God, the reason we surrender is because you have the ability to restore. You have the ability to heal. You have the ability to make whole what's been broken. You have the ability to bring life and hope and truth and purpose in our lives, God. You and you alone, Jesus. That's why when Paul says, I consider everything rubbish, garbage, refuse compared to knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. We connect with that truth, God. We connect with you today, Jesus. and we say, God, we choose to surrender. We surrender our finances. We surrender our desires. We surrender our purpose. We surrender our plan, our way of going. And what, Lord, when you say go right and we want to go left, God, we are going to go your way. We surrender today, Jesus, because we know that surrender brings life. Surrender to you brings hope and purpose, Father God, because we can trust your character, we can trust your purpose, we can trust your desire for us, God, and for your world. So bring healing, bring hope, bring restoration, not just to us as individuals, but to the world in which we live, God. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, God. We thank you. We pray this in the matchless name above all names, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And in your name, God, we say amen, amen, amen. Thank you guys so much for worshiping with us. So beautiful. It's so good to have you here. If you can just have a seat, that would be great. And I just want to say a big welcome. And yes, my name is Jason, and this is also Jason. I'm known as Big J. This is Little J. So we like to have some fun around here. He's the only person I've ever stood next to that makes me feel very, very, very short. And as we kind of dive into things, if it's your very first time or you haven't been in a long while, we want to just encourage you right in the seat back in front of you. And also on the screens, here's a little QR code you can scan. And just take about a minute or so to fill out the information there, and we can get to know you a little bit better. We'll follow up with you this next week. One of our team members will be able to connect and answer questions you might have. Or if you're like, you know, I like the whole like physical route, you can go ahead and turn that card over on the back and actually just fill out the information there. And we've got a welcome kiosk out in our lobby. We'd love to get to know you a little bit better, answer any questions you might have, and just really thankful you could spend this day with us.
I want to say a special welcome to those of you joining us online. I always dream that you guys are on a beach somewhere having fun, but more than likely, you're at work. Thanks for tuning in. We're so glad that you're a part of our family this morning. It's finally here. We've waited. Tonight's the night, 6 p.m. here at the Conquer Campus. It is worship night. Come join us from 6 to 7:30. It's going to be an hour and a half. If you're just looking to come together as a community and worship God, tonight's your night, 6 p.m. here.
That's right. I encourage you as families to bring your kids out. It's going to be a ton of fun as we just seek God together. And then another thing that we're really excited about is, as for me, as a guy who's been married almost a little over 24 years, and we've got two teenagers and a preteen, one of the things I love being a part of every single year is our One Marriage Conference. And so I'd love for you guys to sign up and be a part of this. It's a great way to grow in your marriage relationship, to also grow in parenting, to grow in just the whole hustle and bustle of life that we go through. And if you're saying, hey, I'm not married, but I'm interested being married one day, I want to learn some concepts to help me in healthy relationship, we also encourage you to sign up and be a part of it, but do it soon because it does fill up and we know space is limited, so make sure you sign up right away. It's October 19th. You guys don't want to miss out on that. It's going to be a ton of fun. I know my wife and I have already registered and are looking forward to being a part of it, so we hope you guys will join us for that as well.
It's going to be amazing, our marriage conference. If you call the Bay Church home, we're going to continue worshiping through giving. There are three simple ways that you can continue to invest through the Bay Church to not only affect those across the street, but around the world. As our ushers come forward, you can drop it in the buckets in just a moment. You can also text the number on the screen. You can also give digitally at thebay.church/give or through the giving app. Well, as those buckets begin to pass around in just a moment, Pastor Ryan's going to be coming out with a special guest, but take a moment, turn to your neighbor on your left and right and say, good morning. It's so good to see your smiling face.
What's up, guys? Nice to see you today. I'm Ryan. This is my friend Yoav, and got a special announcement for you. I want to let you know that in about a year and a half, in February of 2026, the Bay Church is going to take a special once-in-a-life pilgrimage to the Holy Land, to the land of the Bible. And we're going to spend about 2 weeks in Israel, see all the places where the Bible happened. Then we're going to do an extension, and we're trying to figure out where that's going to be. Either we're going to go to Egypt, or maybe Italy, or my personal favorite, do a Letters of Paul cruise in Turkey and Greece, the land of the Bible. Our trips come in two basic types. We got the deluxe trip, and we got the budget trip. Hallelujah. So that everybody can get over there. We got the fancy time, like you want to go stay in King David's personal apartment, and then we've got the frugal, like you're in a tent, like the Israelites, don't complain. And they're both great. You see the same stuff. Why do we do this? Because our first core value here at the Bay Church is biblically centered. Everything we do at the Bay Church wants to emanate from the Scriptures, and there is nothing that's going to grow your connection to Scripture like being in the land of the Bible, walking through the actual place where these things happen. It revolutionizes the way you read the Bible. With me is my friend Yoav, and he is our tour guide. Whenever the Bay Church goes to the Holy Land, he's the guy who's taken us from site to site. So Yoav, introduce yourself and say a few words.
Shalom, everyone. Thank you, Pastor Ryan. Thank you for having me over here at church. So I just want to invite you to come to my world, the world of the Bible, the land where Jesus walked on water, where he was teaching the disciples, the land where the Danites found a new city in the north. There's a lot of things that you can learn by being in the world of the Bible about, and then understand the words of the Bible better. If you drive there, when you walk there, when we do our teachings over there, this is an unforgettable experience that will enable you to see the words of the Bible in 3D, and I really encourage you to come over. And if you obviously have questions, I'll be here outside, and Ryan will tell a few things about it later. Thank you again. Toda.
When I lived over there for several years, I knew a guy from Texas, and together we were going up to the Sea of Galilee where Jesus did his ministry. And this guy told me in his deep Texas drawl, he said, "Ryan, I just want to swim where Jesus walked." It's hilarious. You'll get it when you go home. As we all know, that part of the world has been full of conflict and very rowdy over the last year. And I want to let you know, tonight and actually this whole week, Yoav is going to be in town sharing an insider's view of what it has been like to live over there for the last year. Tonight, after the worship night here at the Concord campus at 7:30, he's going to take an hour, hour and a half, give some information, plenty of time for Q&A. Israelis don't even know what politically correct means, so you can ask all your questions and get a direct from the ground view. And then tomorrow night, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, he's going to be presenting in different homes. And you're invited. If you'd like to have a chance to spend some time with Yoav, actually hear substantively his what the world looks like from his view, please come. Tonight there will be a Zoom link too. If you can't make it in person, you can watch by Zoom. Here's what you need to do. Email Karen Bible, and she'll connect you with the details. Karen@thebay.church. Karen@thebay.church, and she will connect you with all the details to get you to people's homes. Last, Yoav's going to be out by the fireplace after this service, so go say howdy, ask him your questions, get to know him a little bit, because he's a guy that we'll hopefully spend some time together with in the Holy Land, okay?
Thank you again.
All right, thanks,
guys. See you later.
Time for some Bible study now.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you guys today. I hope you can use some encouragement. We are in a, calm down, whoever that, I'm looking around, freaked out the front rows too. I may be sitting with y'all real soon. Here's our title for our Bible study today in Romans, the 10th chapter. Everyone can go to heaven. The Bible promises that. Truth is, sadly, tragically, unfortunately, not everyone will. And you say, John, what's the line of demarcation? I'm not going to tell you because it's spelled out in such simple clarity in Romans chapter 10. In a few moments, you'll fully understand. It's not a trick, not a religious formula, not some kind of insider secret sauce. It's just simple biblical truth about actually what it means to know God. And we'll unpack that as we work through our study today. I want to encourage you, if you have not loaded the Bay Church app, take a second, do so. Go to the Concord campus, and all the notes for our Bible study today are going to be right there for you. And again, those of you on live stream, we just are happy you're joining us as well. And we're off and running. Now, when we arrive at Romans chapter 10, we're going to divide the chapter, this study, in two ways. First of all, we're going to go pretty rapidly through some key verses in Romans 10, and then we're going to pivot, and in the second half of our Bible study today, we're going to talk about you and me. So in the first half, we're talking about how God set aside or chose a human family, the nation of Israel, in his master plan to save the people of the planet. That's clearly what's happening here in the 21 verses of Romans 10. But then I want to talk about how God wants to use you and me to bring his message of grace and truth to the thousands of people that you and I are surrounded by every day of our lives. And so part one, part two, let's dive in. Let's look at verse number one, and I'm just going to be reading the verse as we go along verse by verse. This is what Paul writes in Romans 10:1. He says, "My heart's desire, my prayer to God is for the Israelites that they may be saved." You know who Paul's talking about? His own countrymen, and that makes sense. I mean, every country has a sense of loyalty or bias toward your countrymen, you know, your language and habits and food and just the things you hold dear to your heart. And Paul deeply loves his people, the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, and he's saying, man, God raised up the Jewish nation to be the delivery vehicle for the arrival of the Savior, the Messiah, and yet he came unto his own, and his own received him not. They were the very delivery vehicle because Jesus was simultaneously fully God and fully man. And in the human side of it, his ethnicity, he was a Hebrew. He was Jewish. And so Paul and Jesus would resonate in understanding the heartbreak that largely both then and still today, there is strong resistance among the Jewish community to Christ. Not all, but in portions of. And so we're going to talk about that as we move through these verses. Paul's going to help us understand why he is yearning in his heart, praying to God passionately that his countrymen come to Christ. Now, some of you that may be newer to the Bible are saying, whoa, as I get a little bit familiar with this book, I was surprised that two-thirds of the Bible, the first two-thirds, are largely about the Jewish people, the Hebrew people, starting with a guy named Abraham. Now, admittedly, the first 12 chapters of Genesis, we're dealing with creation. We're dealing with God putting all things into existence. He spoke them into existence. We arrive at chapter 12 of Genesis with Abraham, but from there through the balance of the Old Testament, two-thirds of the Bible are about the Jews. We actually owe a great debt because as flawed and as imperfect as they have been, just like we would have been had we been chosen to be the delivery vehicle for the Savior of the world, we still owe a great debt to the Jewish community, to the Hebrew people. You say, John, what do you mean? Well, in a very real sense, the Hebrew people are our spiritual fathers and mothers. They are the people that delivered Messiah. They are the people that gave us so great a salvation. They are the community that introduced us to Torah, the law of God. The Ten Commandments, easily the premier ethical code in the history of the planet. The prophets, Father Abraham, understandings of holiness and justice and sin and sacrifice. It's to the Hebrew people that we owe gratitude for covenant. Even things that we hold dear in American culture, like marriage, it all began in that context with this special chosen group of people. So just bear in your heart that gratitude. That's what's happening in verse 1. Paul wants his own people to come to Christ, the mystery being Jesus was Jewish, and he came into his own, and they received him not. Look at verses 2 and 3. Let me read it to us. Paul continues, I can testify about them. Now, the them here is the Jewish people. He's saying that they may be saved. I can testify about the Israelites that they are zealous for God, but their zeal's not based on knowledge. You guys know what zealousness is. It's passionate enthusiasm, religious fervor. He's saying they are zealous, but it's not a zeal based on knowledge. Goes on in verse 3, since they did not know the righteousness of God and sought to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. You say, John, what do you mean they did not submit to God's righteousness? What Paul is implying here is that God's righteousness is imputed or given or extended to us in Jesus Christ. We exchange our sin for his sinlessness. We exchange our death for his life, abundant life now, eternal life on the other side. It's the exchange of the ages. And when we, by simple faith, believe and receive, we receive the righteousness of God that comes only through Jesus Christ, who indeed is God in the flesh. That's what Paul's implying here in verses 2 and 3. Now, zeal is not the deal. Zeal is not what qualifies as legitimacy. What I mean by that is sincerity or zeal is not the key to being right with God, because you can be very sincerely zealous and over the top, but what you're actually trusting your zeal around, the body of content, the subject, the big what, may be entirely wrong. And so that's why our first core value here at the Bay Church is we want to be biblically centered. We take our cues from the Word of God. Sincerity is not the key to being right with God. It's the content that we believe in, the actual subject that we believe in, the big what, which is to say, Jesus Christ and him crucified and raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. So if sincerity were the issue, cults, which have been myriad over the last couple thousand years and still today prolific, they would be in very good shape simply because they are zealous, very, very sincere. But when you look at what they actually put their faith in, pretty perilous. You could even argue something like the neo-Nazis. You can't argue against their zeal, their passion, their sincerity. But is the actual subject of that which they're putting their faith in, does that authenticate or legitimize their zeal? No, it does not. And that's what Paul's implying in a relative manner to the Jews in verses 2 and 3. Look at verse 4. I'll read it to us. Paul goes on to say, but indeed Christ is the culmination of the law. Remember that word culmination. So that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. It's so simple, it's irritating to us as human beings. We want to have a code of conduct. We want a corpus of behavior defined. We want to do something about it. And God says, no, no, repent, believe, receive. It's that simple, as a little child. Not childish faith, child-like faith. And that is very hard in a learned culture. In fact, the Bay Area, up against many cultures across the United States, we're one of the hotbeds of higher education, the UC Berkeleys, the Stanfords, and we have great respect for higher education just from little children as they enter the world of academia from kindergarten on. We just value, and if you're a public school teacher, great honor and respect. Some of you choose to homeschool. Some of you send your children to private Christian school. Whatever it may be, we honor that. However, when we come to the fact of Christ being the culmination of the law, meaning Christ is the logical end or fulfillment of the law, meaning the first two-thirds of the Bible, the Old Testament, the law of Moses and of Israel, Christ is the culmination of that so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes, that leaves those of us in a logic-based, empirical-based culture, kind of numb, kind of like, you know, we're incredulous. You got to be kidding me. I need evidence. I need to see empirical proof. But the world, the spiritual world, human beings created in God's image are body, soul, and spirit, and there is a big spiritual dimension to who we are as human beings. And to understand spiritual truth, it doesn't mean that you need to go in some kind of a spiritual trance or religious ecstasy, but it does mean that we begin to awaken to the spiritual side of our lives. We are a logic-based, a rational-based, a taste, touch, see, smell, experience, culture, but in the spiritual world, that's where we learn the childlike faith of believing in God. And that's not abandoning reason. It's not abandoning rationality. It's a different dimension. See, we don't have to see to believe. We have to believe to see. So you and I could have been one of the 12 disciples that walked closely with Jesus for 3 years. Not all of them actually trusted and believed in him. And they heard every one of his teachings. They saw every one of his miracles. And yet they're like, count me out. Okay, so it's not seeing to validate it. It's believing in the person and the work of Christ alone. And then a whole vast drama opens before our eyes as revealed in Scripture. Christ is the culmination. He is the natural completion of the point, the purpose. The Old Testament has set the stage for the New Testament. The Old Testament has teed it up for the New Testament of faith in Christ alone. Now, notice what the end of verse 4 says. Righteousness for everyone. For who? Everyone. For who? Everyone. One of the things that's been hard for the Jewish nation, and honestly hard for the human family, is we are a hateful bunch. We're a racist bunch. If you go back through human history, cultures are always hating on other cultures, and I mean the world over. Man's melodrama of human history is one continuous cycle of inhumanity to mankind, that great cruelty, that great judgment. And so when we come to these verses, and the ground now is a level playing field, and we'll arrive at it in the moment where Paul's going to say, there is no longer Jew and Gentile. There's no longer the good group and the bad group, or the arrived group and the wannabes. God sees all people equally. And that's what's beginning to happen here in verse number 4, when righteousness for everyone who what? Believes. So simple. You're beginning to sniff and sense and feel what that opening statement I made, that everyone can go to heaven, but not everyone will, because not everyone will believe. But start with the faith that you have. Remember, after the resurrection, some of you, this will be new information. For some of you, it'll be a refresher. Even after the resurrection, one of Jesus' disciples was a very kind of scientifically logic, rational-based, empirical dude named Thomas. And he said, and the other disciples were saying, I've seen Jesus alive. He is not dead. He is alive. The tomb is empty. And Thomas essentially said, unless I see it, I won't believe it. And then later that day, Jesus appeared, and Jesus looked at him kindly and said, Thomas, put your hands in the holes in my wrists and in the holes in my feet, which is where you put the spikes when you're crucified like this. Put your hands there and see that it's me. It's not a ghost. It's not an image. You know, we're not at the Haunted Mansion at Disneyland here, Tom. It is me, and you know who I am. And then he fell at Jesus' feet and said, my Lord and my God. So start with what you have. He won't judge you. He'll welcome you with open arms. Look at verses 9 and 10, everybody. Let me read them to you now. Romans 9 and 10. Here is the jugular vein of the answer to the question, who goes to heaven? If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, that's the first big if. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's it. For it's with your heart that you believe and are justified, verse 10 continues, and with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Now, I want you to notice what is said, and then significance and conspicuous by its absence is what is not said. If we declare with our mouths, Jesus Christ is Lord, not if we declare with our mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins, which in fact he did, but thousands and thousands and thousands of people were crucified and died on crosses. It was probably the most used Roman form of capital punishment. They're not saying that. They're saying not that Jesus Christ died on the cross, but that Jesus Christ is Lord. What does Lord mean? Lord means ultimate ruler, master of the universe, final majesty, God Almighty, that Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. And then if we believe in our heart, there it is again, that God raised him from the dead. Again, notice, not that he died on the cross, but that God raised him from the dead. If there was a piece of jewelry first century believers would have worn to identify their faith, it wouldn't have been a cross. And I have a beautiful little cross I wear quite often. They would have actually worn an empty tomb. That's what they would have worn, an empty tomb. Because millions have been crucified, only one. And this is eyewitnesses, both his followers and his vehement opponents by the hundreds, acknowledged that with their eyes they were eyewitnesses and saw him after he had risen from the dead. Only one in history can be validated to have said, to have defeated the ultimate and final enemy, which scares all of us humans so badly that one day we're going to die. In rising from the dead, we could say that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, God the Son, God in the flesh, Jesus killed death forever when he rose from the dead. That's why the Bible says, death, where is your sting? So when we have in the house here big funerals, and we have a lot of funerals, and there's a casket here with a body, I look at it, and if I know this person, had relationship with them, and know them to have been a believer, I say, dear friends, what we're looking at here is just kind of a shell, a tent. There was an occupant there, and the occupant has now left and gone home to be in the presence of the Lord. And there will be a great and final resurrection. But this is the most beautiful natural thing in the world. And by the way, the New Testament doesn't describe death as death. For believers who die, the New Testament calls it sleep. Not some intermediate spiritual state, but simply like when you close your eyes and you sleep after a long day at work, you wake up 6-8 hours later and you go, oh my goodness, it's already 6 a.m. I got to get up and go to work. It just passed that quick. That's what happened. It's promotion day when we leave this body and this life and we are promoted into the next life. And so Jesus killed death when he rose from the dead. Now, let's look at our final verses here before we talk about you and me. Look at verses 12 and 13, everybody. Here it is. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. If you're wondering, John, how would I call on the Lord? Just whisper his name. God doesn't grade our prayers. God looks at the heart. The scripture's abundant. God doesn't consider stature, appearance. It's not a deal to God, academic prominence or vocational accomplishment or wealth acquisition or financial bottom line. There is no Jew or Gentile. The ground is level in the sight of God. Each human being is equally important to him. Verses 12, there's no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. Just whisper his name in simplicity and he will be there. I promise you, don't make this harder than it is. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who believes. Let's pivot and talk about you and I today. We can't be Paul 2,000 years ago in ancient near Mideastern culture. The Roman Empire is at its preeminence, its transition from republic to empire. Caesar, Pompey, even Augustus are gone. It's now the middle first century. Rome was ascendant, zenith of empire. In fact, so much so that the vast holdings, the conquered territories of the Roman Empire, 360 degrees, girdled the Mediterranean Sea. And so the Romans called the whole Mediterranean Sea that Ryan was talking about a few moments ago, he wants to take a cruise on. That was called our Roman lake. The Romans considered it their lake. How humble of them. Very gracious that they'd let us sail upon their waters. So we can't be that, but what we can be is what we are, which are citizens of a 21st century culture and society. We are people who have, in some sense, little linkage to the geography of the past. But remember, there is no Jew nor Gentile. Red and yellow, black and white, we are all precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. And so God is going to reveal himself to us in light of Scripture in ways that we 21st century Americans can understand. And I think that as Paul is crying out in verse 1, our very first verse, let me read it to us again. He says, my heart's desire, my fervent prayer to God is for the Israelites that they may be saved. Okay, good on you, Paul. And we continue to have a debt of gratitude for the Hebrew peoples. But what about you and I? And so what is the circle of your love? What is the scope of your compassion? Who do you have, you and me, in our world that we are crying out to God in prayer for, that they come to know Christ? Who do we have a simple yearning in our hearts that this person that we simply care about would come to know Christ? So let me do a little litmus test here, if I may. I suggest we need to look, each one of us, at our sphere of influence, and that would be our friends, that would be our family, that would be our colleagues, that would be our neighbors. So let me ask you, and be honest here, have any of y'all got friends? Even one. You say, yeah, I think they're my friend. I don't know if they'd reciprocate and call me their friend. Put your hand up. Count them in. Have any of you all got family members? You didn't arrive here alone, so we all got family. Have any of you got colleagues? Have any of you got people that journey with you in your vocation, your career, okay, so that you can provide the necessary means of day-to-day living, right? Have any of you got neighbors that you have built relationship with, deeply care about? Do you have some of those? By the way, I got to tell you, I've discovered the greatest neighbors in the world. And I'm just being honest with you. I don't know why it took me this long. I wish I had discovered how fun it is to live by these people 50 years ago. No joke, because I've had some crabby neighbors. Here it is. I'm just going to say it. You all got to, sometime in this life, live next door to Filipinos. That's what you need to do. They are the happiest. They are the sweetest. And so we live, and they just, like, when you know, like, people like me have, like, a baby dedication. We have 8 show up, and 2 came uninvited. When Filipinos have a child dedication, honest to God, I didn't believe it either, and I went, and I'm like, 400 people show up. I mean, people will fly in from freaking Manila. Yeah, we're just going to the baby dedication. So the Filipinos that live next door, they are just the greatest neighbors in the world. And here's the thing. I think every Filipino secretly thinks in their heart that they're Elvis. I think they think Elvis was Filipino because at 10 o'clock when they're having their parties, the pool's going, I can hear the waterfalls. They've got pigs roasting on various barbecues. I mean, it's unbelievable. The music's just going blue Hawaii, whatever. And then 10 o'clock seems to be when the party starts. Now, the next door neighbor, known as John and Carrie Gregg, a.k.a. your pastors, We go to bed about 8:15, 8:30. Yes, we are the boringest people in the world. But then we hear Love Me Tender, and we get out of bed, we pull aside the blinds, and we just start cracking up. Because they don't just sing Elvis, they do Elvis with all the hip stuff and the white cape. And they're, honestly, I love living next to Filipino people. In the next life, I want to become an honorary Filipino if they'll let me in. It's unbelievable. All I got to do is yell. All I got to do is yell over the fence. And I'm not going to say their names. Hey, so-and-so. We know each other. We help each other out. Do little projects around each other's houses, watch each other's houses when we're away. I'd say, hey, it smells good over here. Oh, John, come on, get your wife, get your whole family. Whether it's just me and Carrie, if I brought 42 people over, they could care less. The food is endless. The hospitality is endless. I'm telling you, life is good to be me. I'm just wanted to share that today. Now, we got a problem here, and I'm going to get to that right now, and I want you to listen to me as we talk about you and I sharing our faith, more importantly, demonstrating our faith by how we live before people. We have a problem, and if we will learn this principle, it will change your faith, and it will change your worldview, and your worldview will become much more a bibliocentric, a New Testament lens on how you see and understand life. And here's the principle. Unbelievers, people far from God, whatever, people who've not yet begun their relationship with Christ, watch this, they are not our enemy. They are victims of the enemy. Do we understand this? Because over my whole life of, at 16, I came to Christ, and I've kind of seen two kinds of believers, just in sort of passing serendipity observation. It's not been some kind of an intentional thing, but it's been so distinct and marked, I couldn't not notice two kinds of believers and two kinds of churches. There are believers in churches who, when they think about people who have yet to begin relationship with Christ, so the unchurched, whatever term you may want to use, they see in their mind, this is their knee-jerk reaction, they see first the unworthiness of the sinner. They think in their mind, that's a sinner. That's a sinner. It's like getting cooties on the third grade playground. You guys remember cooties? Ooh, that's a girl. Don't touch a girl, you'll get cooties. And there are believers that kind of act like, and here's the thing, I say, do y'all remember what you were before God in His amazing grace rescued you out of sin and out of lostness and out of addiction and out of behavior which makes you blush a deep shade of shame? Do you remember, or have we forgotten? There are also Christians and churches that see first, not the unworthiness of the sinner, the first thing they see when they look at other people is they see the immense value of each human being, their very essence, because they are perfectly, uniquely, wonderfully created in the image of God. And that's the worldview with which they begin their understanding and relationship with people who've yet to begin relationship with Christ. And I want to challenge all of us today, because I grew up in a church, didn't intend to be this way, but it was the former, not the latter. And so it kind of becomes the Jesus club or the Jesus fortress, and we're inside and we're huddled here and don't mingle, don't coexist. You might get, you know, sin cooties, whatever the deal is. Just hunker down and hold on for the rapture, you know, that kind of a deal. And I'm saying, I got a problem with this, because the Jesus I'm trying to learn to know and to follow, the Bible says He was a friend of sinners. He was a friend of sinners. Sinners liked Jesus, loved Jesus, hung with Jesus way more than religiously informed people. In fact, they were the ones that killed Him politically and legally, but they were also the ones that were constantly setting Him up, trying to trick Him, manipulate Him, extort Him, etc. But it was the common people. In fact, the ordinary person far from God loved Jesus so much that the Pharisees, the religious leaders, began to say, He is a friend of sinners. of tax gatherers, of prostitutes. And he didn't repudiate. He said, that's right. And I could be your friend too, if you weren't whited sepulchers filled with dead men's bones. Unbelievers are not our enemy. They are victims of the enemy. When we see people that have yet to begin relationship with Christ, do we see unworthiness of big fat sinners? Or do we see their immense intrinsic value of each person created in the image of God? Okay, let's take it to the next step. I want to close today with story time. I want to tell you a true story. It's written from a pastor's perspective. I hope I don't hurt your feelings, but it probably will. It hurt my feelings too when I first read it. And sometimes truth hurts before it heals. It stings a little bit before the healing essence follows. This pastor writes, so I was pastoring my church and concerned that very few people in our church and community were beginning to follow Christ. So I began investigating, and the first thing I found out is we were insulated and isolated. We were not at all intentional about building relationships with just regular old human beings outside of us. He said, I met four people in particular, the chief of police, this is a true story, the director of family welfare services, the administrator of the public school system, and a waitress at a local restaurant. The pastor goes on to say, over time, I was able to present the idea of a relationship with Christ to all four of these people on different occasions, but they all gave the same reply. In essence, they said, hey, thank you for your kindness, but I'm not the religious type because I do not want to become a Christian. I don't want to receive Christ as Savior and trust Him for my salvation. And the pastor goes, do you mind if I ask you why not? Don't want to be rude, or I don't want to pry or be insensitive. And they told him. And so the pastor said, I don't know whether it was insanity or divine inspiration, but he got an idea. And he invited these four people to come to his church and tell the church what they had just told him. So, number one, chief of police shows up. He talked about the sheer terror that police officers felt when the radio crackles with the news of domestic violence in the middle of the night. He knew there was more likelihood of being hurt in a domestic violence encounter than bank robbery. He told us that when he first started his career in law enforcement, he'd go to high school career days and tell students, being a police officer is a noble profession. He said, now today, after 30 years, I feel like I'm more of a human garbage man. Now, don't judge him. He's the person that has served in harm's way to protect us and to enforce law and so forth. He looked the congregation in its collective eye. Now, we have had many times, we have many officers, firemen, etc., in our church family, but also the chief of police. And he looks the congregation in its collective eye and he says, I recognize actually more than a few of you. Can you just imagine you're sliding down in your seat? Oh, God. Is he going to tell? He goes, I recognize more than a few of you because I've been in your homes at 3 o'clock in the morning and I see how you behave. That's why I'm there. And it didn't matter who was Christian or not Christian because it seemed like we arrested as many church people as non-church people. And after a pause, he concluded, it seems to me that if this Jesus you believe in was really true, it would affect the way that you behave. Okay, Pastor, that's all I have to say. See you guys. And boom, he walks off. So, and this next line doesn't surprise me. The pastor said, this next week, my phone rang off the wall and several people left the church. Okay? And a wise pastor would say, good, excellent. Not because you don't love those people leaving, but they will create drag. They will become obstacle. They will create sort of pride blockage from trying to understand what it means to really know, follow him, and to love other human beings. Week two, the director of child and family services offered her rationale for not receiving Christ. She said it was because of the pain in her past. I knew that she self-identified as an extremely angry feminist lesbian who had major complications in her life, but what I did not know, she had grown up in a so-called Christian home. And she went on to describe the distance, the separation she saw between the Jesus of the Bible and the Jesus of her home and the Jesus of her church. And she told of the painful early development years of her life and the awful hypocrisy that violated and destroyed her as a young person. a very deep sense of sickness descended upon the people of my church that next week. And he said, and some more people left our church. Oh, we're just getting good, folks. Week three. Week three, the school board administrator said, I don't want to receive Christ because if this Jesus was really real in you, I believe you'd be known more what you are for than what you are against. His image of a Christian was an angry person who opposed a lot of things that he deeply supported. He just saw people of faith as mean, angry, judgmental people. Remember that license or that bumper sticker that was so popular for so long? It's not exactly appropriate, but it gets the point across. Mean people suck. And that was her worldview. It was her truth. Don't judge her. It's what she experienced and how she felt. Now, let me tell you what I experienced on that very same line. Because I didn't grow up in a religious home, at 16, it was a whole new world. And with what I saw that was happening in lives and churches and what I read, I begin to see an ever-widening line of demarcation. There was a disconnect, an incongruity, a gap growing ever wider. And one of these is in public situations. And many years ago, I went up to the mayor of our community after a public thing, and I said, sir, can I be honest? I don't want to overstep, but I think we irritate you a lot. And he goes, John, I know you enough. He goes, do you want me to honestly answer? I said, please, because I'm honestly a little confused. I was still in my 20s. He said, I've been in public service, government for 35 years, whatever. He goes, the only time I ever see you Christian people show up is when you're trying to kill me or protest against me or throwing things at me or dropping a lot of nasty bombs on me with cuss words. And so he goes, you guys never show up just to help. You never show up with a sweet, servant-hearted spirit. The only time you ever show up is when you are ready to run us out of town. And he goes, you know, somebody does that to you for 30, 40 years, you start to get uncomfortable with them. And that changed my life. That's one of the reasons we birth compassion at the Bay Church. We're not going to bait and switch. We're not going to proselytize. We're simply going to give homeless people, however that circumstance may have evolved in their life, we're simply going to wash with warm, clean water their dirty, cold bodies so that they can realize once again the dignity of what it is to be human. You don't have to say a word about Jesus. Just love human beings. By the way, for those of you that are new, this is not a boast, just a fact. We're doing that to about 4,000 homeless people every year. We just got a second shower trailer. We think we can go 7,000 people this year. Not a boast, I'm simply saying when we started with one stall and one shower and rusty plumbing, this is what has happened. And the same with our food. If you come to our campuses on Saturdays, we are giving away tens of thousands of dollars of the freshest food. That's why we're in our public schools. Do you know right now in the Mount Diablo School District, where we are right now, do you know how many elementary age school children are homeless? The number is 800. Now think about that. Our reality for most of us that our kids at least have a bed to sleep in, for God's sake. They might actually have breakfast or dinner or something in between. I mean, all the assumptions that we're like, yeah, that's, I deserve this. It's my right. I'm entitled. For these 800 little kids, how do you do homework when you haven't got a home? Who helps these people? Who looks out for these people? And even in the foster system that we're also deeply involved in, and domestic violence, when these children age out, do you realize what happens to boys and girls that turn 18? They're now young adults and they age out of the system. Do you know how much the evil of human trafficking gobbles them up? So I say these things only because if we can hear these facts, these realities, and either be unaffected, not care, and not do something about it, I have to question, and I'll speak only of myself, I would have to question my very essence. Am I even a person of faith? Am I even a follower of Jesus Christ? Because if how I'm behaving, how I'm living, is diametrically opposed to what I say I believe, that is a serious problem here. Fourth person, fourth Sunday in this church we're talking about. The speaker in round four was the waitress from the coffee shop. She called me the day and she said, is it okay if I bring some of the other guys and girls that are waiters, waitresses at the coffee shop with me? The pastor said, you bet. And she goes, and would it be okay if we sang a song? And I can see the pastor, he goes, what song? Is this going to be Led Zeppelin or what are we talking about? You know, whatever. She goes, actually, we like Amazing Grace. He says, yeah, that'd be great. So he goes, I wish you could have heard those five or six waiters, waitresses, as they sang an a cappella, three-part harmony, Melt Your Heart arrangement of Amazing Grace. And then this initial waitress, little petite gal, stood up before the microphone and said, I need to tell you why I'm not comfortable accepting Christ. Although by how she sounds, I think she already has. She told us why she didn't like to work on Sunday and why, in fact, all of them, everybody fought about who got stuck with Sundays at that little restaurant. And she said it wasn't because it was the Lord's Day, it was because of the clientele, she said. She said it was almost totally church people. She said, and what we've discovered, not saying everybody's like this, we've discovered that church people are often the most demanding, rude, insensitive, cheap, gossiping people, and their children are out of control. They take over the restaurant. And if we say anything to their kids, we're going to be in a lawsuit. She goes, that's just not the kind of person I'd like to become if I joined your church and gave my heart to Christ. This story concludes. Week 5 marked the beginning of a season of cleansing and repentance in our church. I can't begin to describe it. We lost a number of people, but we gained many more, and a mighty season of harvest began. We, as believers in Christ, are carriers of the greatest story ever told. That's our problem, is how we behave relative in relationship to what we say we believe is a massive turnoff for rank-and-file, ordinary, good, tax-paying citizens, our neighbors in the Bay Area. So what if we changed our behavior? And what if we just started loving and serving? See, our job is to love people. God's job, and only God's job, and only God can do this, is to save people. So that's why we say in one of our core values from God's word that we are very gracious in acceptance, but we're not going to compromise truth, but we're always going to love human beings in spite of what lifestyle they're currently involved in a moment. Because I can tell you for sure, that's exactly what God did for this big fat sinner when I was 16. I'm being serious, and I've never forgotten that. I am a debtor for the grace God gave me. And I am obligated to extend that same transcendent grace to other human beings for the rest of their lives. We're just going to love people and let God do the saving, the forgiving, the grace restorative work, right? Stand to your feet, everybody, would you please? I want to pray, if I may, for all of us. And I want us to think about what we've just talked about together and studied together in Romans 10. And then when we leave this auditorium in a minute, how we shall then live when we exit. Let's pray. Father, we began by tracking with the Apostle Paul and his passion to see the people of the Israelites, the nation of Israel, come to Christ. And they were the very ones that were the providers, the carriers of Messiah to the planet, and yet they've largely rejected him. We've seen today in Scripture that salvation is for everyone. There is neither Jew nor Gentile. There's not a caste system. There's not a ranking order. There's just human beings. And you love all of us equally and unconditionally. God, then we've talked about, honestly, perhaps spiritual blindness in our hearts relative to the way we behave in public settings and restaurants as we go day-to-day life in our neighborhoods and how we do what we do. And God, I'm asking that where there needs to be repentance in the house, I know there does in my heart, let there be repentance in the house. Where there needs to be honest to God, coming clean conversations, may that happen. So God, let us either change our behavior or change our name and not call ourselves a Christ follower anymore. But we cannot straddle the fence. We're either all in or all out. And God, we are choosing today to say as a community, We want to be all in. Would you show us how? If you need to spank us, spank us. But please be patient with us, because we are way too blind and our heart has grown calluses. Help us as we say we love God to demonstrate that by an unconditional love for human beings, all human beings created in your image. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And everyone said, amen. When you leave today, Carrie and I would like to warmly invite you to join her and I and Ryan and Sarah in Feb March of 26. It'll be a 2-week period in there with an extension trip. Come to the Holy Land with us, because all you've been doing to this point is reading the Bible. But when you go to the Holy Land, you will see the Bible. You will walk in the Bible. And it will be like the scales are taken off your eyes. So begin saving now, begin planning now, and let's do this once-in-a-lifetime spiritual pilgrimage together, okay? So Yoav is out in the lobby if you'd like to visit with him. Then tonight again at 7:30, he'll be right here. No, 7:30 afterwards. I think it's 7:30. I think, yes, it is 7:30. Hey, everybody. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and in Jesus' name give you grace and peace. And I love you so much.